Good evening, everyone, and welcome to the third annual JCON Real Estate Conference. Tonight's event is brought to you by the JCC of Marine Park and my dear partner, Rabbi Yehoshua Wurdy of CHYE. Let's give a big hand for... My name is Shia Rubenstein, and I am the Executive Director of the JCC of Marine Park. We run a social service and a community organization which started in Marine Park and Baruch Hashem grew to service three of the five boroughs. We offer many different services and programs, including very specifically trying to help people in Parnassa, whether it be free computer courses or otherwise, and we've matured. If I could just ask you to either take the conversation out or... And the JCC, Baruch Hashem, matured from helping individuals, which we still do, finding jobs and computer courses, to doing great events like this evening, bringing people together in different industries. We had in February at the Palace a very successful e-commerce conference which brought over 700 people in the e-commerce space together. And Baruch Hashem, we have a sold-out event tonight. So welcome, and for those who couldn't make it, maybe they'll come next year. We have a great evening for you. We're going to have our first speaker, David Greenfield, who is the CEO of Met Council. Or as many of you have known him for the past 8 years as the New York City Councilman in Borough Park. David has accomplished a lot. I'm honored to call myself a friend. David used to be a landsman in Marine Park, and he went far beyond where we all thought he would. So he accomplished so much as a city councilman, and most recently became the chair of the Land Use Committee and Zoning in the New York City Council until he left his position recently to join Met Council of Jewish Poverty, which is one of the largest nonprofit agencies, or maybe the largest nonprofit Jewish agency in the city of New York. I want to just quickly thank some of our sponsors and make one or two acknowledgments, and I know that I stand between you and David, and then we have a fantastic conversation with Jordan Sloan, our keynote speaker turned keynote conversation, which will be moderated by my dear, dear friend Joe Applebaum of Ajax Union, a brilliant mind in marketing. I do want to acknowledge my friend Mandy Pellin, all the way from Los Angeles, so welcome. Donald Cranston from Senator Marty Golden's office. And believe it or not, Miss Lovely, and her name really is Miss Lovely, of Congresswoman Yvette Clark's office, and Signature Bank, Eastern Union Funding, our partners who helped promote this event, PTEX, EPI. I just don't want to miss anybody. My dear friend Srilly from Madison Real Estate. Where are you, Srilly? He's busy talking on the patio, but thank you so much for helping make this possible. And my staff at the JCC who really helped make tonight's possible, Ellie Hofstetter, Yitzi Weinberg, our dear friend Baruch, where are you Baruch, our event planner. So without any further ado, and without, I really hope I didn't miss anybody, but if I did, I apologize, and we'll try to have it at towards the end of the program. But without any further ado, David Greenfield.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Shia Rubenstein. I just have to say that, you know, the Met Council on Jewish Poverty, we are the largest Jewish charity in New York, and we service 225,000 people a year. And we have 16 JCCs, Jewish Community Councils, throughout the city of New York to try to service the community and to really be the face of the community. And I will say that we do not have a more innovative executive director or a more hardworking JCC than Shia Rubenstein and the JCC of Marine Parks. So I want to thank you for that, and thank you for the invitation. I'm actually going to put on my timer. Shia told me, he says, you have 7 minutes to speak, And so I'm going to make sure I don't go over 7 minutes. And he says, why don't you just talk about the future of zoning? Which is funny because I actually give this class in Brooklyn Law School. I'm an adjunct law professor, and I do it in 5 months. So I'm going to attempt to give you 5 months worth of knowledge in 7 minutes. This is going to be a little bit of a challenge. But if any of you are really interested, you can sign up and take my class at Brooklyn Law School. So the real, you know, I actually was thinking when I was coming in here tonight that last year I got a phone call from a friend of mine who's a real estate developer. I was actually a real estate investor. He's not a developer. He said, listen, he says, can you do me a favor? He says, you know, we've been friends for many years. I have a friend of mine from Chicago. He's like been bouncing around in New York trying to do this project in Brooklyn. I don't know if he's really getting like a straight deal. Can you speak to him and meet with his folks and give him advice on whether or not he can actually do his project? I said, yeah, sure, no problem. A few weeks later, he comes into my office in Manhattan across from City Hall. We sit down and we have a conversation. He says, look, he says, I'm gonna buy the following 5 blocks in Brooklyn. I'm going to rezone it. I'm going to redevelop it. I'm going to build $500 million project. And after an hour, I said, listen, I said, I have bad news for you. I said, what's that? I said, you're not going to do that. He says, what do you mean? I said, it's not possible. I said, what do you mean it's not possible? My lawyers told me it was possible. My consultants told me it was possible. My bankers told me it's possible. I was like, listen, their job is to tell you that it's possible. I'm telling you that as the zoning expert in New York, there's no way you're going to do this. He says, but it's a great project. We're going to bring development and resources and taxes. Like, doesn't matter. Because in New York City, zoning is very complicated. And just because you have a good idea doesn't mean that your idea will actually come to fruition. And the reality is that there's a lot of politics that go into the changing of the zoning. And I said, look, you can probably rezone 1 block, but you can't do 5 blocks. So he was very upset, and his lawyers were upset, and they left. And the next day, I got a call from the real estate investor, and he said, thank you. I said, why? He says, well, he says, honestly, he said, I put together around $25 million in this project, and up until now, I thought it was a $500 million project. Now I know it's what it's going to be, which is a $100 million project. And the first thing to understand about zoning in New York City, and I always tell this to my law students, is it's very complicated, but it's not impossible. Every neighborhood could have a rezoning in it. In fact, right now, the city is in the middle of rezoning 12 different neighborhoods. A few neighborhoods that are coming up, and I'll explain in a second what this means, is Gowanus, Long Island City, Chinatown, Bushwick, Bay Street, Inwood. What that essentially means is the city on its own says, look, we want to change the demographics of this neighborhood. We want to create more affordable housing in this neighborhood. So we, the city, are going to rezone large swaths of these neighborhoods, and that means that there is huge potential for development in these particular neighborhoods. And incidentally, the city is very open about this. You can look online and you can see the Department of City Planning, where the city wants to rezone, what they want to rezone, and how they want to rezone it, whether it makes sense for you to go into these areas or not. In many cases, it does make sense to actually go into these neighborhoods. The second thing to keep in mind is that that's different than when you come and say, look, I have a property and I have a building and I want to rezone it. And the first thing I say when it comes to that is the context matters, right? If everything around there is R2 and people have large single-family homes on 50 by 100 lots, it's going to be very difficult for you to say, look, I want to build an R7A multi-story, multi-family building. And so the first thing I always encourage folks to look at is to say, look, how are you going to make an argument to the city? Because the first stop is you have to go to the Department of City Planning. How are you going to make an argument to the Department of City Planning that your project fits within the context of the rest of the neighborhood? So if you have R6, you want to argue R7, that makes sense, but R2 to R7 is kind of tough. Those of you who don't know the difference between R2 and R7, you can also look that up online, but remember, I'm just doing 7 minutes, a 4-month class. So the latest buzzword that we have today in rezonings is affordability. That ultimately is what the city is going to care about. When you come with a project today and you say, look, I want to convert a gas station into an apartment building, there is a new requirement in the city that you must set aside a certain percentage of the building has to be affordable. This is a big deal. So every time you look at a project, you have to automatically calculate that some percentage, between 20 and 30% of that project, will have to be affordable. The key really is how affordable, and that's where the negotiations can begin with the city and next the other partners that matter, which are the community board, the council members, and in some cases, unions as well. Let me explain what I mean. A lot of people make a mistake, which is developers come in, they try to apply for rezoning, and they don't go to the key stakeholders until the end of the process. And the reason it's a mistake is because you can get very good information for free by speaking initially to the local council member, to the community board member, and to other key stakeholders, and in some cases unions, which I'll talk about in a second. Because if you come to a council member, the council member says, look, I'm not interested in having housing in this neighborhood. You could stand on your head and spit wooden nickels. It's not going to happen. And unfortunately, a lot of people just forget to do the very basics of due diligence. And it's amazing because I'm always amazed when this happens to people because developers, they'll run every single number. They'll figure out exactly how many square feet they can build. They've got every calculation, the discount rates, percentages, the bonds, how they can finance it. And they don't do the basics of just talking to the local community and saying, hey, would you support a project in this neighborhood? If you don't have that support, it's going to be very difficult and challenging. So I would recommend that you speak to the council members and community board members as well. The unions are important on larger projects. The reality is that in this town, it's very difficult to build a big project. Big project is anything in the neighborhood of $50 million and up, $50 million and up. It is very difficult to build it without union. It's not to say that you cannot. The unions have a lot of influence, and depending on the neighborhood, they could really try to stop the flow of that development. And so you have to keep in mind sometimes, you may actually, when you're doing a larger project, you may need to build union, and you have to consider what the cost of that will be as well. I have 3 minutes left. I just want to focus on some of the sort of deeper insight in terms of the changes that we're seeing in the future of zoning. The first is that the city is moving now to restrict M zones, all manufacturing zones, from any construction of hotels. This is actually a very big deal. Right now, there has been in the opportunity for the last few years, a lot of people are building hotels in manufacturing zones. It's actually a loophole, right? Manufacturing zones were not intended for hotels. That's why they're called manufacturing zones. The city figured that out. And they're now in the process of closing that loophole and requiring a special permit, which will make it very difficult to build those. So just keep that in the back of your mind. The city has already restricted storage facilities in some manufacturing areas, something to keep in mind as well. They're in half of the manufacturing zones in New York City, we call them industrial business zones. The city has decided that you cannot build any residential in those areas. It's amazing to me how many developers will come and say, look, I want to build residential, when the city has already said, we're not building residential. So that's just a waste of time as well in terms of something that you're working on. Then the final thing just to keep in mind is that the city right now, and this is actually a very big deal, is in the process of changing the city charter. The city charter is the city's constitution. There's a lot of people who would like to give more power to the communities and community groups and to community boards to stop development. This is important because if you're about to undertake a project and the city's going to change its charter in the next 18 months, which is very possible, you need to at least consider the possibility that your project may have different hurdles than you have originally anticipated. And this leads me to the final point, which is that once you've gone through the process and once you know the basics, and certainly if folks are serious, you can reach out to me and I'm happy to give you free advice in terms of the basics as well. You need more important, in my opinion, than your lawyer, and there are only 100 good zoning lawyers in New York City, is your lobbyist. You can't really pull up a project like this without bringing in a professional to help you navigate the challenges of the community board, the council member, community benefit agreements, the unions. It's really very important. And we see a lot of people. I remember a developer came in from Philadelphia a few years ago. He came in with a project. It's a great project. It's a $100 million project in Long Island City. 10 years later, it has not moved because he insisted he does all his development in Philadelphia. He can do it in New York City. New York City, folks, is different than anywhere else in the world. And that's good and bad. The good news is that all of you know New York City, so you have an advantage. But if you're coming from elsewhere and you're trying to navigate that process, you need a professional to help you do that. It's the equivalent of an architect. You wouldn't design your own building on your spare time in your basement and say, look, I'm going to sketch out my building and we're going to do it. You can't really do it without professional help as well. And that's really the final piece that I just want folks to recognize, which is everything is really doable in the zoning world, and I think is huge opportunities. It's just that it takes time. It takes 2 to 3 years from conception until execution. But if you go through the process and do the research and actually get things done, you really have huge opportunities because you can, in fact, take empty pieces of property and turn them from manufacturing to commercial or to residential, or in some cases, mixed-use projects as well. And I think a lot of people don't look at projects from that perspective because it's not a quick fix, but there's a lot of potential in the city. We're running out of space to say, look, we want to rezone. The city wants to rezone. It's just a very complicated process to actually getting there. I am officially out of time. I thank you for allowing me to give you this quick primer. And if you have any other questions or concerns, feel free to reach out to me. I'm very happy to give you some perspective. Thank you very much.
I think I'm the first to sign up for the course.